Hello, Paul Dooley at the anchor desk with some late breaking news. It is day 14 of Wachtell Watch, and USA Network veteran Jeff Wachtell still holds the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment. For more on this ongoing story, let's go to our reporter, Hal Lublin, outside NBC Universal's Burbank headquarters. Hal, what can you tell us?
Thank you, Paul. It is day 14, and we're on the Wachtell Watch. 2 weeks since Jeff Wachtell was named President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
Hal, to confirm what I just heard you say, Jeff Wachtell is still in the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
That's correct, Paul. Jeff Wachtell, after 14 days of what I can only describe as 2 weeks, is still in the newly created position of President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
That's what I thought you said, Hal. In his new position as President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment, what content will Jeff Wachtell supervise?
TV content, Paul.
Hal, you know, in our business, you can never be too sure. Do you have confirmation of this?
Paul, I'm holding today's communique confirming that Mr. Wachtell is 14 days into his new job as President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment.
Paul Dooley back in the newsroom. Hal, 14 days, that's a fortnight, right?
I'll have to get back to you on that. What I can confirm is that Jeff Wachtell is in day 14 of his new position as President and Chief Content Officer, NBC Universal Cable Entertainment. For KPFK 90.7 The Bone, I'm Hal Lublin on the Wachtell Watch.
Thank you, Hal. Great work. Stay safe. And now, back to our 24-hour coverage of the riots in Koreatown.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. DavidFeldmanShow.com. On today's program, I'm going to run some of the sketches that got cut from yesterday's radio show because we ran out of time. Plus, Michael Snyder, our resident film critic, stops by to tell us what movies to avoid this holiday season. Paul Dooley, Hal Lublin, Eddie Pepitone, Janie Haddad Tompkins, Jeremy S. Kramer, Rick Overton, Kevin Rooney, and Will Ryan also join us. David Misner wrote the cover story for this week's Nation magazine. He says 2013 is the year of the hunger strike. We had him on the show earlier, very briefly, so I'm going to run the entire conversation. Portions of today's show, written by Hal Lublin, David Weiss, Will Dixon, and David Feldman. As usual, we got a lot of show, so let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
The David Feldman Show is made possible in part through the generous sponsorship of Jerry DePetro Chevrolet of Redlands at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restrooms.
Jerry DePetro Chevrolet at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restrooms.
Hi, I'm Debbie DePetro of Jerry DePetro Chevrolet of Redlands. The weather outside may be frightful, but deals at Jerry DePetro Chevrolet are delightful. You can lease an all-new 2014 Trailblazer for zero down and $289 per month.
Did he come yet? Did I miss him?
Who?
Santa Claus, you dumby. I know he's coming to town. I heard a song about it on the radio.
Jimmy, I'm in the middle of doing a commercial for our holiday sales spectacular this weekend. Why don't you go help Mom decorate the tree?
I'm not allowed near the Christmas tree no more. Not since last year when I made a number 4 in a box of ornaments.
What's a number 4?
It's a number 1 with 1.5 number 2s. You go ahead and finish your commercial while I wait for that fat bastard to get here.
What do you have against Santa Claus?
Daddy keeps telling me that I got put on his naughty list. We'll see who's naughty when I knock him out with this tire iron, make a number 7 in his bag, and then lock him in the trunk of a 96 Lumina.
Ho, ho, ho! You've never seen deals like these at Jerry DePetro, so come on down and see me, Santa.
I gotcha.
Jimmy, that was Dad in an outfit.
Oh, no. Now I made a number 11 in my pants. You win this round, Santa Claus.
Seriously? Somebody call a doctor.
Jerry DePetro Chevrolet at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, restroom.
That's Jerry DePetro Chevrolet of Redlands at the corner of two streets in Redlands. Sales, service, sleigh bells.
Hi, I'm Christian Diamond, the okay-smelling plumber, older half-brother of Mike Diamond, the smell-good plumber. Is hiring my half-brother, the smell-good plumber, draining your wallet? Hire me, the okay-smelling plumber. Here are some testimonials. Anna from Whittier writes,
"My son's bris was truly a cut above. Everything was going Jewishly perfect until my neighbor, Mrs. Magusian, somehow got free of her restraints and bolted upstairs with speed belying her 89 years and rocked a double deuce in my steam shower. So I called Christian Diamond, the okay-smelling plumber. He arrived around 20 minutes late and smelled okay, with notes of barbecue sauce, wintergreen, foot odor, and just a hint of Axe body spray. The clog was gone sometime between 10 and 2. Thanks, Christian Diamond."
Thank you, Anna. I'm Christian Diamond, the okay-smelling plumber, reminding you not to touch that.
1-800-SMELL-OKAY.
If it's big and it's brown and it won't go down, call me,
Christian Diamond,
the okay-smelling plumber.
Is ChristianMingle.com leaving you lonely, angry, and adding to your list of dates from hell? Hi, I'm Christian Mingle Jr., oldest son of Christian Mingle Sr. Is using my dad's Christian dating site so frustrating that it makes you doubt the existence of God? Try mine, the ChristianMingleJr.com dating site. Anna from Whittier writes,
"I'm a single Christian woman. It's hard as H-E double hockey sticks to find a partner who shares my values. So I posted my profile on ChristianMingleJr.com. In a month, I met a man who walks in Jesus' sandals and his Siamese twin who didn't. It was awkward that first time, but you can get used to anything, you know. Thanks, ChristianMingleJr.com.
Thanks, Anna. Well, folks, this is Christian Mingle Jr. reminding you not to touch that.
1-800-SMELL-OKAY.
It's Christian Mingle Jr. jingle reminding you to buy the all-important service he provides.
My father was a remote man.
Are you on your knees praying for a bigger return on your investments? Hi, I'm Jesus Christ, inviting you to invest in the Jesus Christ Iron Fist Investment Fund. It's an exchange-traded fund that's averaged a 50% annualized return for over 2,000 years. Why give money to the Son of God? Simple. We invest in companies with low prices, high dividends, and a social conscience. Companies like Walmart, Exxon, and Whole Foods. I'm Jesus. I never sleep, and neither should your money. Get your keys to the kingdom of heaven.
1-800-SMELL-OKAY.
The David Feldman Show is available as a podcast for free on iTunes. For a treasure trove of more free stuff, I invite you to check out DavidFeldmanShow.com. where you can find podcasts, radio shows, and reading material dating all the way back to 2009. And it's all free. DavidFeldmanShow.com. And while you're over there, I invite you to subscribe to my newsletter. Michael Snyder, our resident film critic, joins us. Yesterday, he told us which movies to catch this big holiday box office weekend. Today, he tells us what to miss, and those movies include 47 Ronin, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, Oh, that's too bad. I was hoping to see that. And Grudge Match. Let's start off with The Secret Life of Walter Mitty. That's worth missing, really?
Yeah, absolutely. As a matter of fact, I'm telling you about these movies because I know a lot of people overeat at Christmas dinner. And if you want to, you know, get a little spiritual or actual physical bulimia going, you know, and get rid of some of this this excess food that you've taken in, these movies will be sure to bring up the past. Speaking of the past, I'll bring
up
the past.
That's a good movie to see.
The past is a good movie. I'd rather I brought that up and sent you there than see these things. But The Secret Life of Walter Mitty is inspired by a classic short story by the humorist James Thurber. See, it's the past here. We're talking about the past.
Who's in the past? That's a good movie. You mentioned it yesterday.
Berenice Bejo from The Artist. She's wonderful in that. But let's...
So go see the past.
Yeah. Let's talk about The Secret Life of Walter Mitty. Thurber wrote a story about a daydreamer who has this sort of drab life. And in order to escape it, the full escapism, he comes up to these crazy fantasies and finds himself in the middle of all that. And things don't seem so kind of boring after all. They made a movie of it with Danny Kaye, which was even more fantastical and filled with all kinds of songs and choreography and chicanery and flights of fancy and kind of fit his manic antic style. You know, it was sweet. It was sweet. What Ben Stiller has done as the director and star, probably all over the script of this remake, ostensible remake of The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, has turned it into some sort of half-ass action comedy romance that just doesn't work on any level. I mean, let's put it this way. You got this wonderful short story. You get this more elaborate Danny Kaye vehicle that at least has the spirit of the short story. And this quasi-action comedy, by the way, starts out at the defunct Life magazine, presuming that it's still in existence, where the Stiller character is a photo archivist who's misplaced an important negative sent to him by his kind of hero, this world-renowned, globe-trotting photographer, played in the movie, by the way, by Sean Penn. Support from Kristen Wiig as a fellow worker he has a romantic interest in, Adam Scott, Patton Oswalt. You know, these are pretty terrific performers. And you also have effects work and all kinds of stunts and whatever. But it just seems like sound and fury signifying very, very little.
So go see Macbeth.
You're not supposed to mention that.
You were quoting Macbeth.
Yeah, but you don't mention the name of the play. It's bad luck in the theater. And this is, of course, a theater of sound. Come on.
Okay. That's disappointing.
I know.
I love Patton. So, all right.
Oh, he's not bad. He plays some sort of guy at the end of a telephone line that the Walter Mitty character is in contact with as he reaches out on various dating services looking for true love. It's pretty weak sauce.
Okay. 47 Ronin.
47 Ronin is a lot of money spent with a big and elaborate samurai epic starring a variety of very talented Japanese actors, including the terrific Rinko Kikuchi, who is in Pacific Rim as the female lead. Unfortunately, they are surrounding the star of the movie, which is Keanu Reeves, who plays a half-breed, masterless samurai or wannabe samurai who gets involved in a vengeance plot because the master of their particular house has been killed by a shogun. And so these masterless samurai, 47 of them who are banished, decide they're going to get revenge. And Kai is going to lead them, this outcast played by Keanu Reeves. It just, you know, there's like shape-shifting creatures and, you know, CGI dragons and what have you. And Rinko Kikuchi plays a witch who is on the side of the bastard who's caused all the trouble to begin with. And it's fun to watch her. She's pretty talented. And all of these sword and sorcery samurai epics, which used a lot of wire work and physical, practical effects, they still have some of them in here and some martial arts stuff with swords and staffs. But there's now a lot of CGI that creates all kinds of rippling robes that people can disappear into and turn into smoke and whatever. And it kind of takes the fun out of the samurai movies and the strange, magical, mystical period dramas that we've seen from Hong Kong and Japan in the past. I think this thing actually tanked in Japan itself. I've never been able to buy this guy as anything more, and by this guy I mean Keanu Reeves, anything more than the cipher he portrayed in The Matrix, which, by the way, was one decent movie and two stiffs.
Okay. Grudge Match. How can this not be fantastic? It's got Sylvester Stallone, Robert De Niro reuniting after their triumphant performances in Copland. How can this not be a great, great movie?
I have to say that I thought this is a comedy. And it's all about two aging boxing rivals. But, you know, they could have called Grudge Match Last Stop Palookaville. It's Rocky meeting the Raging Bull. It's a weak and well-meaning attempt to get a little fun with these two geriatric tough guys who portray guys who have had a long-standing grudge since a couple of matches that never settled who was the better fighter back in the day. They're now in their 70s, and they're trotted out, saggy breasts, creased faces, hard of hearing, problematic, to have one last bout when a shoving match after an attempt to make a video game ends up on YouTube, goes viral, and forces a demand for these two guys to have that third and final fight to settle once and for all who was the better fighter, even though they're old guys where one punch could, like, kind of break 17 or 18 bones. Kim Basinger plays the woman that came between them that caused the original grudge. Looking pretty good for a woman that's supposed to be hanging out with guys in their 70s. Alan Arkin plays the trainer that Stallone's character relied on, who is now in an old age home, and he trots this guy out to help him from the ring corner. And Kevin Hart is the young, devil-may-care promoter who wants to bleed these guys for every penny he possibly can. And I know, look, De Niro is like, it's the Michael Caine theory. Do as much work as you can. You know, do three lame movies so you can do that one great film. I mean, maybe that's Caine's philosophy at this point.
But here's the big question. Everybody's waiting for the answer to this big question.
Okay.
Who's the better actor, Stallone or De Niro?
Oh, God, it's truly a grudge match there, because we all know that Stallone, you know, has a range from A to B. It's like an SNL skit that's been extended way too long, kind of like this review. Peter Siegel is the director. You know, I just really, you know, they did actually use footage when they were showing the old footage from their original bouts. They used footage from Raging Bull and Rocky. It's kind of hilarious. Okay. But that's the most hilarious thing about Grudge Match.
Michael Snyder, thank you for telling us.
Michael Snyder. Michael Snyder, thank you so much for telling us
what movies not to see
this weekend. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And if people want to follow you,
how can they do that?
Well, Dave and Davina, I would suggest they go to @CultureBlaster on Twitter. Check out my page on Facebook, Michael Snyder's Culture Blast. Like me at Facebook.
Thank you.
Michael Snyder.
Can Chef Gordon Ramsay bring Gitmo back from the brink of disaster?
Chef Rodriguez, you call this liquid protein?
Yes, I do, Chef Ramsay.
This is crap. I am gobsmacked by your lack of passion.
That's your opinion.
It's pig slop. How dare you even think you can serve this to an unlawful combatant? I have never, ever, 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 ever met someone I believed in as little as you. You dirty little pig!
I won't eat! I won't eat!
Chef Rodriguez, I order you to shove the tube through his nose.
If he won't eat, he won't eat.
I want my lawyer!
Chef Rodriguez, shove the feeding tube through his nose! You're an idiot! A moron! You call this a feeding tube? Look at this! It's filthy!
I'm sick of you telling me how to do my job.
Look how lumpy the protein in this shake is. How can this slop possibly move through the feeding tube? It's as clogged as your brain.
That's your opinion.
That's it. The kitchen is closed. We're closed for the night. You work like a pig. General McAdams, what's going on here? This is a disaster.
I wanted this place to be special. A nice little prison for enemy combatants to be held without a trial. It's all crumbling down around me.
You have to be as demanding of your staff as you are of yourself.
They walk all...
What? Speak up. They what?
They walk all over me.
Because you're not a man like your father.
Gitmo was once the crown jewel of the military penal system. Can Chef Ramsay restore its former luster?
Let me get this straight, soldier. You're waterboarding this customer?
Yes, I am, Chef Ramsay.
You have any idea what kind of trouble you can get us into?
You mean the Geneva Conventions?
No! The health department! That's the same hood you used on the customer you waterboarded an hour ago.
Sorry. Chef Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares, this Tuesday on Fox.
Shut it down. Shut the entire place down.
Just when we're done with Thanksgiving, Christmas is around the corner. I can barely fit into my pants. It's an impossible time of the year to stay thin. Time for dieting tips. David Misner writes for The Nation, has a great article about staying thin during the holiday season. It's called Starving for Justice. It's in this week's edition of The Nation magazine, which everybody should subscribe to. And they got some great beauty tips this week on staying thin while everybody's attempting to feed you food that's horrible for you. Welcome to our show, David.
Nice to be here. Thanks.
So you're recommending the way to keep your boyish figure is to starve for justice. What is this new dieting tip you're talking about?
Well, I have focused on hunger strikes. So that's basically when the state is violating your rights, disregarding your dignity. You try to get them to change their behavior by refusing to eat.
And you're calling 2013 the year of the hunger strike.
That's right.
I was just joking around here. This is some pretty serious stuff, and I just wanted to lighten it up a little. I did an interview with a reporter, Paige St. Clair from the Los Angeles Times, about the hunger strike up in Pelican Bay.
Right.
This has been a serious year where people who are trying to change the world have stopped eating. It's passive resistance. We just lost Nelson Mandela, who, along with Martin Luther King and Gandhi, taught us that you can really change the world not through violence, but by passive aggression, which I think my mother has also shown, is an expert at, although she always told me to eat. You don't need to be violent. You can really change the world through passive resistance. Why are the powers that be so threatened when prisoners, and it's specifically men in prison, why are they so threatened by prisoners who will not eat?
Well, mainly because they don't want them to become martyrs, and they don't want them to draw attention to the brutality of their circumstances. Now, some government officials and some governments are more threatened than others. American officials, Jerry Brown and others, are less threatened than some other government officials in other countries. But it can be ineffective. And when I looked into this, I was surprised, number one, by how many hunger strikes there were around the world. It's kind of astounding.
Was 2013 a record year for hunger strikes?
Well, I think so. There's been no social science that's really documented it. All the experts and hunger strike watchers I spoke to who've done research on past years agree that there certainly has been a rise. It's hard to tell how steep the increase has been.
On a mega, meta, broad scale, just give me some headlines where the major hunger strikes have been. So we have them in Pelican Bay. Your article, Starving for Justice, which is in this week's Nation magazine, which everybody should subscribe to and donate money to. Your article begins with the hunger strikes in Israel conducted by the Palestinians. Give me some of the big headlines of hunger strikes from 2013.
The two that Americans are certainly most familiar with, and they were big stories not only nationally but internationally, were the ones in California and the ones at Gitmo. Gitmo became a huge story. I mean, people have been hunger striking really forever. I mean, since Gitmo came into existence, there's really never not been hunger strikes. But they never became a big story until last spring when more than 100 prisoners joined the hunger strike, and they forced it onto the front page, and they forced President Obama to revisit this issue. For over the past few years, there's been a lot of hunger strikes in Israel by Palestinians.
Right.
Pussy Riot, Tola Konnikova, I think is how you pronounce it, she launched a hunger strike along with another woman from Pussy Riot. They both went on hunger strikes this year. There was hunger strike in Colombia. I was astounded. If you go and Google, pick a country out of thin air, a sizable country, and Google hunger strike, you're almost certainly will find that there was a noteworthy hunger strike in that country this year. I don't have hard data to compare it to past years, but no one doubts that there has been a huge increase.
Right. Refresh my memory. It seems to me the hunger strikes in Gitmo were really embarrassing to President Obama in 2013, and they were force-feeding the prisoners.
They still are. They still are force-feeding. It's still going on, which is a violation of international law. Yeah, they, you know, although I say they, hunger strikes are often successful, I think it would be kind of an insult to say that the ones in California or Gitmo were grand successes. The prisoners are still in solitary. They're still at Gitmo. But consider where we were a year ago at this time. President Obama had just won re-election without talking about Gitmo. I think John Stewart was the only one who made him even talk about it. He hadn't transferred any prisoners off of Gitmo in months. In fact, he was claiming falsely, as a matter of fact, that he didn't have the power to transfer prisoners away. And then last February, the hunger strike started, and it kept growing and kept growing, and it became a big story. And President Obama actually ended up starting to transfer. He transferred two prisoners this summer as a direct result of the hunger strike. It was the first transfers in a couple of years. And now there's traction in Congress to try to close Gitmo, and I think you can give a lot of credit to the hunger strikers. And yes, there is still what John Stewart calls food boarding, a campaign of brutal force feeding to keep these people alive, because what they don't want to do is to have martyrs.
Right. They don't want to have martyrs. That's why Hitler's bunker, there's now, I think, a condominium over Hitler's bunker.
Right.
They won't show us pictures of Osama bin Laden or give him a burial. They do not want martyrs. Martyrs terrify the power structure. When you say President Obama transferred some prisoners, to where?
Well, this is controversial, too. There's no good answers for Gitmo. I'm not going to say there are. He sent two prisoners home. I believe, back to the countries. Now, they're probably going to be detained when they get back, so it's no,
right.
And maybe they're not guilty, so it's not a beautiful solution. And he actually just transferred another prisoner home where he feared that he's going to be tortured, so that's not a beautiful circumstance either. So he has to either try these people or release them eventually. There's no other options.
Now, force-feeding a hunger striker is almost worse than waterboarding. It's a form of torture. It takes about 2 hours. They run a silicon tube down your throat. There's a choking sensation. I mean, you really have to commit to the hunger strike once they start force-feeding you.
It's a horrible procedure. You probably saw that video of Mos Def. He underwent it this year. Yeah, and that's why the
Mos Def, waterboarding or force-feeding?
Force-feeding. He went through the procedure. There's a video you can check out. I don't know if you saw it.
No, I didn't.
It went viral this year, and he sort of breaks into tears. He just wanted to draw attention to the brutality of it. It's an excruciating procedure. Now, I would say it's immoral and unethical to keep somebody alive, you know, against their will, even if you could do it humanely. But this is using a brutal form of a violent procedure to keep people alive and doing it again and again and again. There's been one prisoner at Gitmo who's been food boarded basically every day, I think, for years. This is, I say, the American Medical Association, the World Medical Association, the Red Cross all regard it as a crime.
They all regard it as a crime. Are there doctors who are assisting in this at Gitmo?
Yeah, I think so. And that's a controversial thing, to say the least.
Right.
So that's one thing that I hope, you know, would come out of my article.
Yeah, yeah. We're talking with David Misner. He's a novelist, and we'll talk about your novels in a second. You're also a journalist, and your article, Starving for Justice, is in this week's Nation magazine. Subscribe to The Nation. Donate to The Nation magazine. I consider it the greatest magazine in the history of American journalism. Let me just process this. You're being held in Gitmo, or you're being held in Pelican Bay, and we have international listeners, and Jerry Brown is the governor again of California, who I voted for, and I voted for Barack Obama.
Right.
There are prisoners in Pelican Bay in solitary confinement who are protesting the conditions at Pelican Bay, which our Supreme Court has called inhumane. The most conservative Supreme Court in my memory has ruled that the California prisons violate the Bill of Rights, that they have to be emptied out. So there are hunger strikes in Gitmo going on. There are hunger strikes in Pelican Bay. And in order to go on a hunger strike, you have to be pretty desperate.
Yeah.
But then to be force-fed, it's bad enough that you're starving, but to be force-fed a couple of times a week and endure that kind of torture and commit to it, you must be really angry with your treatment.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, of course, not every person who launches a hunger strike goes the distance, so to speak, but a lot do, and it is usually a form of activism of the last resort. You're desperate, and this is one way you have of exercising control. And I find it, you know, it's nothing to celebrate, certainly, a hunger strike, even though I would admire their courage and their attempt to seize and use what little control they have. Tragic if it gets to that point. But yeah, these people, you know, I don't think anybody got force-fed in California, but nonetheless, a lot did go on fast for more than 40 or 50 days. And when it gets to that point, your life is in danger.
Yeah. You write that 30,000 prisoners in California started the hunger strike.
Right.
The numbers went down, but after 40 days, dozens, you say, were still fasting.
Yeah. Yeah, this is not...
Is that still...
You don't do that as a publicity stunt or to make a point. You do that because you're angry and you're oppressed and you can't take it anymore. And, you know, some of these people have been in solitary for decades.
Right.
And the UN chief torture investigator says that solitary for more than 15 days should be considered torture. A lot of people have been in there for decades.
Right. I'm reading your article again, and it says nearly 200 prisoners in California have spent more than a decade in solitary. And Governor Moonbeam, Jerry Brown, my liberal visionary governor,
right.
Is he taking people out of solitary, or is he insisting that it's not really solitary confinement?
Yeah, that was one of the more absurd things when one of the arguments coming from government officials that there was actually not solitary confinement in California, and they relied on some sort of technical definition. He wasn't under much pressure, you know, unlike the Palestinians, for example, and I'm not going to pretend the Palestinians have it good, but they're part of a broad social movement. The possibility of martyrdom really exists, and Israeli government is under a lot of pressure. Not so in California.
Well, it's tough. It's tough.
Yeah.
Because for the Israelis, because I cannot imagine being stuck in a prison cell with a bunch of Jews saying, eat something nonstop. Will you eat something? That's how I grew up. So
that's why they don't have force feeding. They just have that.
Just to shut my mother up, I would eat. You're too thin.
Yeah, the UN has regarded that as cruel and unusual, too.
So, yeah, the UN has criticized California, and you say they're not force feeding in California prisons, and they're not force feeding the Palestinian prisoners in Israel, correct?
Well, in California, they ended up not force feeding people, but towards the end of the hunger strike, I think it was called off in October, they did get a federal judge to say they could, so they were prepared to. And I think they were going to. Israel has, jokes aside, they've had a relatively humane policy so forth. They've followed the guidelines of the World Medical Association, which doesn't allow force feeding. But now they're going to pass a law, or they're poised to pass a law to allow force feeding, because they probably, presumably, because they've watched the United States deal with their problem and guard against martyrdom by just keeping people alive. But it wasn't, you know, it's still a PR problem if you're abusing people in that way, but it's better than having them die. So I think Israel is going to try to go down that road.
What Bobby Sands, when I was growing up, he was the IRA prisoner who conducted his own hunger strike. How did that play out for him? I don't remember.
Yeah, I mean, that was, you know, that's sort of the model, if I can use that word, of a quote-unquote successful hunger strike, of course. One of the reasons it was successful is that he died. He was martyred, along with, I think, 9 other IRA prisoners. It was 1981, and he went on a hunger strike, and he completely, when he was in prison, he actually won a seat to the parliament. That's how popular he became. And it really was it really changed history. He became a martyr. It greatly generated international sympathy for Irish republicanism, greatly expanded their numbers and recruits. And I think you can draw a line between what he did and ultimate resolution of the troubles.
Speak to that, please. Go on with that, please. But I'll tell you why, because Nelson Mandela has just died.
Right.
And I often wonder if the system, the powers that be, put people like Mandela, Gandhi, and Martin Luther King in front of us because they're martyrs who weren't violent. And they try to present these guys to us as the alternative to violence. And it's sometimes I wonder, is that a form of control to keep us from being violent?
Well,
but I have kids. You have kids. It really does. It really passive resistance. Is that what it's called? Passive resistance?
passive resistance. But you got to remember, Mandela was not, I mean, he embraced the use of violence, tactical violence. He tried nonviolence, decided that it wouldn't work, and then did sign off on bombings. So he gave up on nonviolence, and I think, you know, this is a broader discussion.
Okay.
Hunger strikes certainly are.
Hang on. We're welcome back to Fox News. I'm filling in for Bill O'Reilly. And you're talking about that communist, we're talking about a communist, Nelson Mandela.
Right, exactly. He's the communist who embraced violence whom everybody loves.
Did he? Very quickly, he did embrace violence at the beginning?
At the beginning, yeah. He was, I mean, that's why he was, I mean, he was. I don't know the details on whether it was how civilians got killed. I think it was targeted basically at state, you know, it wouldn't be regarded as terrorism. But he was a militant who decided that, gave up on nonviolence, and eventually, you know, but that didn't stop him from becoming a man of peace afterwards and for, you know, embracing forgiveness as well. But the whole issue of justified political violence, that's another podcast, I think.
Okay, but Gandhi.
Yes, he was a big hug.
Was a man of peace.
Well, Mandela did, but I should say Mandela did go on a hunger strike when he was in prison. He didn't start one. He joined one that other prisoners had started. And Gandhi was a famous hunger striker. He went on, I don't know how many, including one when he was about 80 years old.
Martin Luther King didn't go on hunger strikes, but he
was not a hunger striker, but a lot of esteemed activists throughout history, the suffragettes, Cesar Chavez, when you go on a hunger strike, you're sort of embracing this time-honored tradition of a form of activism.
Great. We're talking with David Misner. He's a novelist and a journalist, and his article, Starving for Justice, is a must-read in The Nation magazine this week. The Nation magazine is a must-subscribe. Everybody should subscribe to The Nation magazine. And it is the holiday season, and people should donate to keep The Nation magazine going. What is The Nation Institute? They support young investigative journalists and thinkers and prepare them to go out into the world of journalism, right?
I think so. You know, I'm a freelance writer for The Nation, so you'll have to talk to someone at The Nation that knows more. It's affiliated with The Nation. It's separated probably for tax purposes. I don't really know. But, yeah, they support fellows, and it's – I don't know. That's all I know.
Well, it's a great tax dodge for The Nation.
You'll have to talk to Katina Vandenhoevel or somebody who knows more. I just write from –
Yeah, boy, are they getting rich over at The Nation.
Yeah, they're billionaires.
Well, we'll be back with David Misner, author of Starving for Justice in this week's Nation magazine, right after this.
No, I was just wondering where I could listen to your podcast or go on your website.
Oh, go to davidfeldmanshow.com or subscribe to it on iTunes.
Okay.
Or on Stitcher. So that's the best way to do it.
Okay.
And then give us a good review on iTunes.
Absolutely.
That always helps. Unless you don't like the way this turns out.
I think it sounds all right to me so far.
Yeah, but we edit out anytime you're funny or smarter than I am, we take that out.
Right. Yeah, and then you put in stuff making fun of me.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how it works. We're talking with David Misner. He's the author of Starving for Justice, which is a great article in The Nation magazine this week, which everybody should read. David is also a novelist. Two of his novels you can buy on Amazon. They're Political Animal and Hartsburg, USA. And they are political in nature. I haven't read them yet, but I will after we get off the phone. Your article, Starving for Justice, says these hunger strikes in Guantanamo and Pelican Bay are part of a larger movement of worldwide social activism. What do you mean by that?
Well, I cite a report. There has been a comprehensive report on hunger strikes. In the 20th century, it finds that they spiked during times of years of protests, the 30s, for example, the 1960s, the no-nuke era of the late 70s and early 80s. And so I'm fairly confident that the rise in hunger strikes over the last few years are related to this era of radical protests, which I think it is, whether it's people taking to the streets, the whistleblowing. There's even been a rise in people setting themselves on fire. Dozens of countries, including the United States, activists have self-immolated. And that's the way that the Arab Spring democratic uprisings began. So I think that...
It was a guy who sold flowers in Tunisia, right?
Right, exactly. And they're also... Saudi Arabia also had a smaller revolution that began with a self-immolation. There's an article now at Al Jazeera, I forget who wrote it, talking about the uptick. So I think this is all related. It's a radical era caused by, I guess, radical injustice.
And it's different from a suicide bomber.
Well, yes, it is. I would say it is, although I suppose you could say that's a radical form of protest as well.
Right, but it's hard to call suicide bombers martyrs.
Well, it's hard for us to call them martyrs, perhaps. Not hard.
Well, it was hard for...
Yeah, that's what...
Bill Maher got...
Right.
You know, but they're not martyrs. If you're killing... I mean, the kamikazes were not martyrs. People who blow themselves up in a mosque or a...
Well, not from our perspective, but that's the great selling point. That's how they get recruits, is they convince them that they'll be martyrs.
Right. But are you suggesting that real martyrs who self-immolate or starve themselves to death, do they gain more supporters than suicide bombers? I would think so, right?
Well, I would hope so. I think it depends. But I also, you know, it depends on political circumstances. You know, there was a guy who, a hunger striker, who hung himself. Now, he didn't die from starvation, but it was related to his hunger strike. And that was just a blip because he doesn't have a social movement behind him to hold him up and view him as a martyr.
Mm-hmm.
So
that happened this summer, right?
Yeah.
And are they sure he hung himself? Because I talked to Paige St. Clair from the Los Angeles Times over the summer, and they weren't quite certain.
Well, the state was initially denying that it was related to the hunger strike, but they since reversed and said that it was related. He was a hunger striker, and it was related to the hunger strike. So you could see in another circumstance that happens, and he would become, you know, a symbol of this cause. But mm-hmm. they're not, you know, the Pelican Bay hunger strikers, they have done a lot to get solitary confinement to raise the profile at issue, but they still got a long way to go before.
They got a long way to go because nobody in America cares about prisoners because they think they're never going to get locked up. We always think it's...
Well, they think they're never going to get locked up, and they think that the people are guilty, even they kind of don't, you know.
Right.
Especially the people who view government as a problem. They think that somehow government never fails and puts wrong people in prison.
Isn't that interesting? Isn't that, that's a great point. The people who hate government somehow trust the local police to lock up the right people. Isn't that amazing?
And the prosecutors to somehow, to not be corrupt or to not be make a mistake.
What a brilliant, excuse me for one second. Let's just process that brilliant point, David Misner.
Okay, please do. Please call me brilliant.
The people who hate government. And want government out of our lives always seem to support the police
mm-hmm.
and the prosecutors and the wardens and the prison guards
right.
and the prison guard unions and the privatization of our prisons.
Yeah.
Somehow that's fine. You know, we have to remind them, the people who hate government, that they're running out of black people to arrest.
Yeah.
And they're coming for whitey. They really are. You can only lock up so many black people.
Right.
More and more white people, I notice, especially in the comedy clubs, when I talk about the police, I notice more and more white people have started to distrust the police.
I think that's right. I mean, there's another good article, I think, I don't know, The Nation. It might have been my issue, I call it, but about the encroaching police state. And it's been that way for black and brown people forever, but it's starting to infringe upon white people more and more, and sadly, but that's when it starts to become a political problem for the powers that be, when it starts.
Right.
Same with the NSA. You know, Muslims have been surveilled and spied on for, you know, since 9/11, but it became a problem when it was threatening sort of middle-class white people.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that is, for better or worse, something that can cause change when it's viewed as not just affecting them.
Right, right. We've been talking with David Misner. He's the author of Starving for Justice. It's in this week's Nation magazine. Before you go, this mm-hmm. is what I tell my kids. And how old are your kids?
I got three boys, seven, five, and two.
Okay, so they've already been... radicalized, I'm sure. There's nothing you can do.
They're radical protesters.
Yeah. Well, I have some children who, I don't know where it comes from, but they're not radicalized, but they're angry at our government. And this is what I tell them, and I'd like you to respond.
It's better than being angry at you.
Well, I think they really are. They're using the government. They're sublimating their rage. I say towards
the regime.
Yeah. I say that observing the 60s, I'm too young to have been out there on the streets. But when I look back at the 60s, I think, and a lot of people are going to write to me and complain that I'm saying this, but I believe this. I believe that taking to the streets really didn't accomplish anything. That the marches only angered the right and got Nixon reelected. That middle America became frightened of the 60s radicals. And in a way, it gave rise to the police state. The Republicans were smart. The Young Americans for Freedom, the Young Republicans, they wore white shirts and they infiltrated our government. And they're almost impossible to tackle now. They just understand the workings of our government. And it's manifest in the fact that we have a majority of Americans who don't agree with John Boehner and the Republicans who control the House, but they have been successful in working. The Republicans are successful in working the system, gerrymandering, and keeping unpopular ideas and unpopular people in power. So this is what I tell my children. Don't march on the streets. Don't go to a WTO conference. Don't get tear gassed. The police want you to do that.
Well,
the police want to shoot you. They want to fire tear gas. They want to use their truncheons. Go to school, get into the system, and change it from within.
Wow. This is a big topic with a lot of different angles to it. My kids are...
Well, just give me a one-minute answer.
All right. Well, I would speak really quickly. I would say my...
I'm joking. Respond any way you want.
A lot of the problems you point to are correct. And whether I would advise my kids to become or urge my kids to become involved in radical activism and to risk something, including their lives potentially or their livelihoods, that's another question. I will say that I disagree with you about the power of radical activism. I think it's probably the least worst hope to change things. I think if you look at the constituencies that have actually gotten somewhere over the past few years, immigrants' rights community, President Obama was just visiting hunger strikers, as a matter of fact, immigrant rights hunger strikers, and you saw somebody heckling him there, and the gay rights people have also engaged in some radical forms of activism. Those people have made headway, political headway, and I think that's related to the fact that they were willing and organized, you know, enough to get out there and engage in radical protest.
Define radical protest. I'm not saying don't protest.
Right.
I'm saying, what do you mean by radical protest? What I'm saying is, of course you should take to the streets. Of course you should strike. Of course you should, you know, do civil disobedience within reason.
Right.
But what do you mean by radical protest?
Well, I'm using that term broadly. I mean, I think a march. I think if you go to a protest, that's radical protest. I mean, outside the normal bounds of, you know,
right,
voting and canvassing. I think the protest is the most sort of basic form of radical protest. And you know, I think if you when you start violating the law, civil disobedience is taking it to another level. I do think you're absolutely right, though, that the police is militarized now. I think it's militarized partially for the purpose of responding to radical protest and protecting the state. I think it's a problem. I also think that eventually, probably, there will be radical protest on a mass scale here, and I think the police will crack down. And whether or not, you know, which side the sort of center of the country sides with will determine, you know, what happens. And
I disagree with you, David Mizrahi.
Okay.
I do not think there will be radical protest in the streets.
All right.
I'll tell you why. I think Americans understand what the police want. The police want to fire at Americans. The Americans understand that there's a police state, as you just said, to control the angry 99%. And there's a police state because there's money to be made in giving tanks and drones to our police. And I think most Americans understand that. And I think most Americans understand that the answer is not taking to the streets. It's voting. It's canvassing. It's peaceful protest. And the minute you get these radicals who are throwing rocks at the police, walk away, because chances are, and this is what I tell my kids, chances are if there's somebody taunting the police, he's working for the police. It's a false flag operation.
Right. Well, that's the
answer. So,
but, well, I don't know. You may be right that there won't be radical protests in the United States, and that's partially because things, the government has a knack for giving people just enough money, just enough rights to pacify them, and just enough TV.
And legalizing marijuana.
And legalizing marijuana. And also, you know, a lot of meds, a lot of antidepressants that keep people just kind of like sedated and narcotized so they don't rise up.
Do you think the 60s would have happened instead of the birth control pill, it was the rise of Prozac?
Oh, I don't think so.
Really? Do you think the 60s would
have happened? That's an interesting point. I don't know. I think you can make the case that the government likes the pharmaceutical industry partially because it pacifies people. I'm just talking now. I don't know.
The birth control pill was in the early 60s. It gave rise to street protests because guys realized that they could get laid. They had erections, and they weren't getting laid as much as they wanted to, so they took to the streets. They were...
Very good story, the relationship between sex drive and radical protest, because, of course, antidepressants sap your libido.
Exactly. And that's why we're not taking to the streets.
Now we're getting somewhere.
We need to put Viagra and Cialis in the water with the fluoride, get the men with raging hard-ons, and they'll take to the streets. Okay. David Misner is a novelist, and he is the author of Political Animal, Hartsburg, USA, two novels that I'm going to pick up right after we get done with this interview. And he is the author of Starving for Justice. It's in this week's Nation magazine. David Misner, thank you so much for joining us. Let's give your Twitter handle out so that people can follow you.
It's my name, David Misner, at David Misner, one word, DavidMisner. That's it.
At Twitter. Thank you, David Misner.
Thank you very much. It was fun.
On the next Kitchen Nightmares, Chef Gordon Ramsay travels to sunny Cuba and tries to bring life back to a restaurant whose customers have lost the will to live.
My name is General Onus McAdams. I run Gitmo, very small Muslim clientele. When my father ran the place, we did 400 covers on a Saturday night. Now I have to force feed the customers with rubber tubing. Well, they just won't eat.
Why can't you be a man like your father?
That's my mother. Please help me, Chef Ramsay.
As customers launch a massive hunger strike, can Chef Gordon Ramsay restore Gitmo to its former glory?
I'm Dot. I'll be your server. Is everything okay?
No, everything is not okay. I've been here for 10 years. You won't tell me why. You make me stand in a stress position naked for hours at a time. No trial, no lawyer, no habeas corpus. This is America?
Okay. Someone will be back in a few minutes to take your drink order. Do you have any questions about the menu?
Yes. What did I do? Why am I here?
Our special today is macaroni and cheese and chicken.
How is that special? How is that special? We have that every day.
We liquefy it, and then we run it through a silicone tube into your nose and then straight down your throat into your gut.
My esophagus is burning from the inflammation. How can this possibly be legal? For 2 hours each day, you keep the feeding tube in me for 2 hours. Each day, I'm choking, gagging for air.
General McAdams, this place is falling apart. Where is your sense of shame?
I brought in a new chef 2 years ago. He won't listen to me.
I'm Chef Rodriguez. My kitchen, my rules.
You see what I'm talking about, Chef Ramsay?
Your father is rolling over in his grave because his son is half a fan.
Look at me, General McAdams. Don't you want to be the man your mother wants you to be?
All I ever wanted was to serve home-style American cuisine to enemy combatants being held inside an indefinite detention facility.
Chef Ramsay tries to turn Gitmo around, but first he must make General McAdams and his crew eat a steaming hot plate of humble pie.
General McAdams, where is your passion?
I told you he's here for food.
Your customers would be insane to come back here. Why would they want to eat this garbage, you f***ing twit?
I'm Candy. Can I take your order?
I didn't do anything. Please. It's been 10 years. I just want to go home.
Okay, so that's macaroni and cheese and chicken through a feeding tube. What would you like to drink?
The water from my father's well in Kabul.
Okay, an orange juice.
Can Chef Gordon Ramsay whip this restaurant into shape in less than a week?
Shut it down! Shut the entire place down!
Chef Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares, this Tuesday on Fox.
You watch them tango on Dancing with the Stars and go off the deep end on Splash. But this summer, your favorite C-list celebrities will take your breath away. It's All-Star Celebrity Choke Party, an hour of actors you kind of recognize trying to strangle one another to death. From 8 is Enough, we've got Willie Ames. Olympic skating superstar Nancy Kerrigan.
Why?
And see if you recognize this former Oscar winner. Guest judge, Chris Brown.
I see what you're doing. You're choking with your hands, and you need to be choking with your heart.
All-Star Celebrity Choke Party, Wednesday nights this summer, only on ABC. ABC, we just don't give a shit anymore.
My baby said to me, will you be forever true? I said, I cannot lie. This is my reply to you, indubiubiubidably, indubiubiubidably. Well, I love you eternally, indubiubiubidably. My baby said to me, will you be forever mine? I said, I cannot lie. In the sky, our love will shine. Indubiubiubidably, indubiubiubidably. Well, I love you eternally. Indubiubiubidably.
Feldman Show's available as a podcast for free on iTunes. I invite you to friend me on Facebook, and please follow me on Twitter. If you're listening to this program as a podcast and would like to hear it broadcast, I ask you to contact your local public radio station and say, I want the David Feldman Show. Our executive producer is Troy Conrad. Our producer is Alicia Cordova. Don't forget to sign up for my free newsletter by going to davidfeldmanshow.com, where you'll also find a treasure trove of podcasts and radio shows dating back to 2009. It's all free. Special thanks to Matt Perez, Stan, Tamika, Ali, Lexa, Jimmy Dore, and of course, Alan Minsky from the KPFK Studios in Southern California. I'm David Feldman. Thank you for joining us.